The goal of our study this morning is to compare two law codes, the law of Moses and the law of the Messiah. And sadly, in many of the churches, there's a lot of confusion as to how to deal with the Mosaic law. And on your outline, you'll notice in the introduction, there are three categories of reasons why there is this kind of confusion. And the first problem is making wrong divisions in the Mosaic law. And through church history, they've divided the law sometimes in two parts, where they would make 10 commandments mandatory for today, but the other 603 commandments not mandatory for today. And even for those who claim to keep the 10 commandments, they generally fudge on one of them, and that is the Sabbath commandment. Others make a threefold division between the ceremonial law, the moral law, and the civil law. And we're not under the ceremonial or civil law, we are under the moral law. But not the uniformity as to exactly what constitutes the moral law. As we shall see in this study, the truth is that the Mosaic law is a total of not 10 commandments, but 613 commandments. And that's what we have to clearly understand. Another wrong area is wrong applications. And for example, in church history, often applied the Sabbath laws to Sunday, claiming the New Testament transferred the Sabbath to Sunday, but there's no such passage anywhere in the New Testament that actually shows this. And the Sabbath always will be from sundown Friday till sundown Saturday. We'll say more about the Sabbath a bit later. Furthermore, the problem with clothing laws. There's not so much a problem in America anymore, but with my travels in Europe, especially Eastern Europe, they pull out one verse out of the book of Deuteronomy chapter 22. A woman should not wear clothing made for man, a man should not wear clothing made for woman, and therefore they prohibit a woman to wear any kinds of slacks or pants or trousers. And I actually asked them, well, how come you only follow that one verse in Deuteronomy 22? The same chapter also says you should have tassels on the four corners of your garments. Tassels of white with one tassel of blue. How come you ignore that rule? Another question I came up with them is, when Moses was given the law by God himself, who was wearing trousers? Who was wearing pants? Nobody. Everybody was wearing robes of one kind or another, and the difference between male and female robes is the male robe was one color, the female robe was multicolored, but it's all one color, but it was all the same thing, and that is robes. I just look at this one question in the mainland sometimes, is it permissible to wear jeans to church? And my response is, well, that depends. If those jeans are made by Wrangler, that would be inappropriate. But if they're made by Levi's, that would be kosher. And so wearing Levitical garments was always kosher. And then you have also the problem of dietary laws, where more and more books are coming out claiming we should keep the Mosaic dietary laws because that was given for health reasons. You can read all the books of Moses back and forth. You won't never find that reason given. We'll see what the reason is a bit later. But the issue was not an issue of health. The issue was of a matter of distinctiveness. And keep in mind, as we shall see, the Mosaic law was limited as a rule of life for the Jewish people. And if the dietary law was intended just to keep you healthy, you would have to end up saying, well, God wanted Jews healthy, but he wanted Gentiles sick. And that would not be an appropriate way to interpret the text. And also, there are on your outline, wrong appropriations. Like, that would be Chinese for wrong. And wrong applications, we shall see the law of Moses was given strictly for the Jewish people to observe, not the Gentiles. And nor was it given to the church to be observed. And there's also normally a partial application. And especially in the Messianic movement, they like to proclaim Torah. Not all of them, but many of them. Torah or the law, but practice grace. So for example, they will often tell me, we have to keep Passover. And I ask, why do we have to keep Passover? And the answer is because Moses said so. And yes, Moses said so, we have to keep Passover. But what does the Moses say? Moses also said that you cannot observe Passover at home. You cannot observe the Passover outside of Israel. You cannot even observe Passover anywhere in Israel except one place, and that is Jerusalem. So you're observing Passover in America. You are not fulfilling Torah. You're practicing grace. And also, even most Messianic Jews, for the Passover, follow the rabbinic rule that they no longer serve lamb for the Passover. They serve chicken. In the Passover's Nariah Ministries that I lead, we always serve a lamb because the Bible presents the Messiah as the Lamb of God. Nobody ever called him the chicken of God. But here again, they're preaching Torah law, but practicing grace. Furthermore, the Mosaic law is that you cannot invite a Gentile to your Passover table until you first of all made sure that he was circumcised. Thank God I don't have to check that anymore. Galatians forbids us to make circumcision an issue as far as Gentiles and so on. And so we're going to try to clarify some of these issues. But let me also point out there's more than just these two law codes in Scripture. It began with the Edenic law code with the Garden of Eden. Then came the Adamic law code, followed by the Noahic law code. Then came the Mosaic law code, followed by the, before that, the Patriarchal law code, followed by the Mosaic law code. Now we live under the law of the Messianic law code. In the future, there'll also be a different law code, and that is the Kingdom law code. As you move from law code to law code, you'll see three things happening. First of all, some provisions, some commandments are repeated. Some provisions and some commandments are discontinued. And some provisions, some commandments are given for the first time, never seen before. And that's when you realize you're entering a new age, a new dispensation, a new rule of life. When certain laws are repeated, certain laws are discontinued, and certain laws are brand new, never seen before. And so we'll just deal with two of these law codes, not all of them, in the short time that we have. Let's begin then with the law of Moses, and turn your Bibles to Exodus chapter 19. Exodus chapter 19. Many of you have heard my rabbi stories, and I don't remember what I told here and didn't tell here, but I have a new one that's not a rabbi story, but does have a Jewish connection. It's about a Taliban terrorist running to the desert, fleeing the authorities. And he's run out of water, getting desperate. He looks up to the horizon and he sees what might be an oasis, and if so, it would always have water and trees. When he gets there, he realizes there are no trees, no water, just an old Jewish man selling all these ties and these racks that he thought was trees. And the terrorist asked him, "Don't you have any water here?" The Jewish man says, "Well, I have no water. But I have these nice ties, only $5 apiece." And Tara says, "I don't need your Western clothing. I'm an Easterner. What I need is some water." And the Jewish man says, "Well, like I said, I have no water, but I do have this nice silk tie, only a $5. Tara says, "I wish I had enough strength right now to take the tie and put it on your neck and kill you. I hate Jews. I want to kill Jews. But what I need is to have I need some water." The Jewish man says, "I'll show you I'm a better man than you are. You hate me because I'm Jewish. You won't buy any of my ties. But I'll show you I'm a better man. Just keep walking straight ahead between those sand dunes. You'll come to a crossroads. And there's a nice restaurant on those crossroads and has all the water you could possibly want. So go in peace and may God bless you." The terrorist leaves, but he says, "I may come back and kill you yet. Right now I'm just preserving my energy." He's gone for a while. After a while he's coming back, he's crawling on his hands, crawling on his knees. He's got the $5 in his hand, and he says, "They will not let me in without a tie." Everybody heard me in spite of that noise? Now, following your outline, there's more to the outline that I can cover in this period of time, so I'll be detailing certain facets, I'll be summarizing other facets. And we'll begin then with the recipients of the law, and look at Exodus chapter 19, and we'll begin in verse 3. Exodus 19, verse 3. And Moses went up unto God, and Jehovah called him out of the mountain, saying, Thus shall you say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, Ye have seen what I did unto the Egyptians, how I bore you on eagle's wings, and brought you unto myself. Now therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed, and keep my covenant, then you shall be mine own possession from all the peoples, for all the earth is mine. And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the children of Israel. And notice he specifies that this covenant, which will contain the 613 commandments alone, was given strictly to the same people he just brought out of Israel, and that was the Jewish people, the people of Israel. And what Moses affirms here is also repeated many times over. We'll just look at three examples. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 7. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 7. Deuteronomy chapter 4. Chapter 4, verse 7. For what great nation is there that has a God so nigh unto them as Jehovah our God is whensoever we call upon him? And what great nation is there that hath statutes and ordinances so righteous as all this law which I set before you this day? And notice, to no other nation has this body of rules and regulations, ordinances, and so on, given only for the people of Israel. And now look at Psalm 147. Psalm 147. Verse 19, 147, verse 19. He shows his word unto Jacob, his statutes and ordinances unto Israel. Now notice, he has not dealt so with any other nation. As for his ordinances, they have not known them. Praise ye the Lord. So notice, to no other nation is he given this body of rules and regulations and laws except for the people of Israel. And one more example is Malachi chapter 4. Malachi chapter 4. Malachi chapter 4, verse 4. Malachi 4, 4. Remember ye the law of Moses, my servant, which I command unto him in Horeb for all Israel, even statutes and ordinances. From the beginning to the end of the Hebrew Bible, this was a body of rules and regulations for the purpose of a rule of life for the people of Israel. And it emphasizes to another nation has then been given or required. And then later on, when the Mosaic Law and Covenant was sealed by the Shekhinah, the Shekinah glory, and this is Exodus chapter 24, verses 1 through 11. Exodus 4, verses 1 through 11. It was then signed and sealed in such a way which rendered this covenant a conditional covenant. And that became the rule of life for this period of time. Now, dealing with the provisions of the law, I'm going to make basically six observations. First of all, again, the provisions included 613 commandments, not 10, but 613. Second observation, this was a conditional covenant, which meant blessings for obedience, but curses and disciplines for disobedience. The third observation is the key element was the blood sacrifices. And so in Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11, Leviticus 17, verse 11, this set down a principle. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. And blood was given for the purpose of atonement. And the atonement is what comes by means of blood. In the first seven chapters of the book of Leviticus, he lists in detail five different offerings, of which the first four were blood. The one with what was not a blood offering was the seal offering or the seal offering, Even that was not offered apart from blood, because the first sacrifice every morning was the burnt offering, and the seal offering or seal offering was put upon the blood offering. And as a result, I always came in contact with blood. However, the blood sacrifices of animals never took away the sin. In Hebrews chapter 10, verses 1 through 4, Hebrews 10, 1 through 4 declared, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. However, it's impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sin. The word atonement in Hebrew, kafar, just means to cover, but it doesn't mean to take away. As animal blood, even the bulls and goats, which were the sacred Day of Atonement sacrifices, could not take sin away. So the blood sacrifices of the animal did provide forgiveness for the sin, did provide for restoration of fellowship with the Lord, but did not take the sin away. A fourth observation is that for the Jewish people, it restricted some of the provisions of the Noahic covenant, the covenant God made with Noah, which was the rule of life for the Gentile world. For the Jews, there were certain restrictions. The Noahic covenant said, every moving thing shall be food for you. So if it moves, you can eat it. And that never changed for the Gentiles. Now for the Jews, if there's land animals, they had to have both cloven hoof and chewed the cud. As for fish, they had to have both fins and scales. As for birds, no birds of prey, no meat-eating birds were allowed. And then there was one type of insect that was allowed, a certain type of locust. I've never been tempted to partake of this kind of a locust. Just between, tell it not in Gath and publish it not in the streets of Ashkelon. I'd much rather have a ham and rye than a locust and a bagel. A fifth observation is that for the Jewish people added the death penalty for many other sins, because in the Noahic covenant, the death penalty was mandatory only for those guilty of premeditated murder. But with the Mosaic covenant, many other sins required the death penalty, and a short list would include adultery, idolatry, witchcraft, cursing God, cursing parents, and breaking the Sabbath. And the sixth observation concerns the issue of circumcision. In the Abrahamic covenant, circumcision was mandatory only for Jewish people or those within a Jewish household, but not for the Gentiles. And the Mosaic covenant was still obligatory for Jews and for Gentiles, only for those Gentiles who wish to become participant in the blessings of the Jewish covenants. Then they would undergo circumcision, take upon themselves the obligation of the Mosaic law, live like any Jew would have to live under the law. But otherwise, it was limited also to Jewish people and made available to Gentiles, but not mandatory for Gentiles. Now, capital C, here I'm going to be doing some summarizing the purposes of the law. Let me begin by making clear the purpose was never a means of earning salvation. Salvation always was, is, will be by grace through faith, apart from any works. And these different covenants were not different ways of being saved. These different covenants were merely different rules of life for those already saved. But the means of salvation was always the same, by grace through faith. Now the content of faith, what you had to believe to be saved, was not always the same. And so in Genesis chapter 15, verse 6 says, Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned him for righteousness. What exactly did Abraham believe to be saved? In the first five verses, he believed the promises of God in the Abrahamic covenant. And the content of our faith today is Messiah died for our sins, was buried, and rose again. And that is what we believe and trust alone for our salvation. But the means of salvation was always the same, by grace through faith plus nothing. So in the categories of the personal law and relationship to God, the purpose was to show the holiness of God. Also, the standard, the righteousness which he required for a proper relationship with the Lord. And I'll just give you one verse, there's several. I'll give you one passage for each of these. This one, Leviticus 19, verses 1, 2, and 37. Leviticus 19, verses 1, 2, and 37. In relationship to Israel, there were three main purposes. First of all, to keep the Jews a distinct people. To keep them a distinct people. One example, Leviticus 11, verses 44 and 45. Leviticus 11, 44 and 45. And that accounts for many of the specific types of commandments. For example, the dietary law. Again, it was not for health. Was to keep the Jews a distinct people in their eating habits. Also, Jews had to be distinct in how they looked. And so Jewish men were not allowed to shave their beards. And furthermore, their beards could not be rounded like miners. They had to be corded like Orthodox Jewish people wear them. And so no shaving, no rounding of the beard. Furthermore, concerning clothing, Jews could not wear clothing made of mixed threads. And not only that, they had to have the tassels on the corners of the garments. And there were husband and wife relationship laws, daily habits like Sabbath regulations, and so on. A second major purpose is to provide a rule of life for the saint in the Old Testament up until Messiah died. To provide a rule of life, not a way of salvation. To provide a rule of life for those who have already exercised faith and received their salvation. And the third purpose for Israel is to provide for Israel occasions for both individual and corporate worship. And so Leviticus chapter 23, Leviticus 23, Moses outlines the seven holy seasons that they are to observe. And three of these were for corporate worship, the Feast of Passover, Weeks and Tabernacles. The other four was for individual and family worship, but provided for them in the opportunities for individual and corporate worship. Now, point three, concerning the Gentiles, the key passage is Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 through 16. Ephesians 2, 11 through 16. And he points out that God originally had two ethnic groups, Jews and Gentiles. The advantage of the Jewish identity is that God had a covenantal relationship with the Jewish people. And he emphasizes the word in the plural because God made four eternal and unconditional covenants with the Jewish people. And these are the Abrahamic covenant, the land covenant, the Davidic covenant, and the new covenant. And God's blessings both on the material and spiritual realm come by means of these four covenants. God also made another covenant which was distinctive from the other four. This one was both conditional and temporary, the Mosaic covenant containing the Mosaic law. In connection with the Gentiles, the key purpose was to serve as a middle wall of partition to keep Gentiles as Gentiles away from enjoying the spiritual blessings of the Jewish covenants. And so the Gentiles were two things. Number one, they were strangers to the covenants. They could not had no right to enjoy the benefits. And secondly, they're far off, too far away to enjoy the benefits. And so until, as long as the Mosaic law was enforced, it served as the middle wall of partition to keep Gentiles as Gentiles away from enjoying the spiritual blessings of the Jewish covenants. For Gentile to be able to enjoy it, he again undergoes conversion to Mosaic Judaism, undergo circumcision, live like any Jew would have to live under the law. But Gentiles in their uncircumcision could not participate. And now we come to the issue of sin. And the key passage is Romans chapter 7, verse 7 through chapter 8, verse 4. Romans 7, verse 7 through chapter 8, verse 4. And the first purpose here is to reveal clearly what sin is. That's Romans 7, 7. And that passage teaches, Paul teaches, that before he knew that he never knew that coveting was a sin until he read it in the law. And once he read it in the law, then he realized coveting is a sin. But then he did the best to keep from coveting. And he found himself coveting even more than he did before. And that brings us to the second purpose, relationship to sin, and that is to make us sin even more. To make us sin even more than we did before we knew it was a sin. And that's Romans 7, verses 8 through 11. Romans 7, verses 8 through 11. And the way it works is found in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 56. 1 Corinthians 15, 56. We are all born with a sin nature, but the sin nature needs a base of operation, and it uses the law as a base of operation. So when the Torah said, you shall, the sin nature says, oh no, I won't. If the law says, thou shalt not, the sin nature can say, oh yes, I will. And now the sin nature has something to work against and causes us to sin even more. And that will lead to the third purpose in connection with sin in Romans chapter 7, verses 12 to 25, 12 to 25. And that is to show us that we can do nothing on our own to please God. No matter how well we keep the Torah, we'll never be able to earn salvation. And therefore, it led to the fourth purpose of the law in Romans 8, verses 1 through 4. Romans 8, verses 1 through 4, and that is to drive us to faith. To drive us to faith. And these are the four purposes in connection to sin. Now going down to capital D, the token of the covenant, and that was the Sabbath. I'm going to make five observations about the Sabbath issue. First of all, the Sabbath was the sign or the symbol or the token of the Mosaic Covenant. Not every covenant had a sign connected to it, but some did. For example, the rainbow was the sign of the Noahic Covenant. Circumcision was the sign of the Abrahamic Covenant, but the sign of the Mosaic Covenant was the Sabbath. And that was the token. And every reason God gives for observing the Sabbath is only relevant to Israel. Not the Gentiles, not the church. Exodus 31, verses 12 to 17, I'll be summarizing here. Exodus 12 to 31, 12 to 17, is a sign that Israel has been set apart from God. A sign that Israel is the only nation to be ever set apart from by God. Deuteronomy chapter 5, verses 12 to 17, Deuteronomy 5, 12 to 17, it's a sign of the Exodus. It's a sign that God brought Israel out of Egypt. And God never brought the Seventh-day Adventist church out of Egypt. Only he brought Israel out of Egypt. And Ezekiel chapter 20, verses 10 through 12, Ezekiel 20, verses 10 through 12, it's a sign of Israel being set apart and a sign of the Exodus. And then Ezekiel 20:20, it's a sign that Jehovah is Israel's personal God. And so it's a token of this covenant. A second observation is that the Sabbath was not a creation ordinance. What we mean by the term creation ordinance is any commandment God gave in the context of the creation account. And God did give certain commandments. But keeping the Sabbath was not one of them. In fact, not even the word Shabbat, Sabbath, is not found in Genesis chapters 1, 2, or 3. What is found is the 7 days is called the seventh day, but not called the Shabbat, not called the Sabbath, not called the day of cessation or the day of rest. No, it's a command that first began with Moses in Exodus chapter 16, verses 23 to 30, is the first Sabbath commandment. Given to Jews. And Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 through 11, Exodus 20, verses 8 through 11, was incorporated into the Ten Commandments. Thirdly, the Sabbath was not a day of corporate worship. It was a day of rest. And much of the misconception about keeping the Sabbath is this is the day for corporate worship, and so churches think they should meet on Saturday. But you'll never find Moses ever saying as a command, or God giving a command through Moses, gather together for corporate worship on the Sabbath day. It does not exist. The Sabbath day was not a day of corporate worship. It was a day of staying home and resting, not allowed to travel, not allowed to ride a donkey or a horse or any of those things. You couldn't even light a fire. And one man went out gathering wood on the Sabbath day, and he got stoned to death for doing so. If the Sabbath was intended to be a day of corporate worship, you would have a real problem because corporate worship was allowed only where the tabernacle or temple stood, first in Shiloh, then in Jerusalem. If you lived in Jerusalem, then it would be possible to have corporate worship every Sabbath. But suppose you lived in Galilee, it's a 3-day walk each way. You spend 3 days walking up to Jerusalem. You have corporate worship on the Sabbath day. You would then spend 3 days walking back down to Galilee. You finally arrive home. You kiss your wife hello. Immediately after you kiss her goodbye, make a U-turn to go back to Jerusalem in time for the Sabbath. You would not be working for 6 days, you'd be walking for 6 days and were to worship on the Sabbath. The Mosaic law, corporate worship was mandatory 3 times a year, the Feast of Passover, the Feast of Weeks, and the Feast of Tabernacles. But the Sabbath was not one of them. Now, fourthly, the Sabbath was intended only for Israel. It was never intended for the church. And you won't find any Sabbath commandment for the church, as we shall see anywhere in the New Testament. And fifthly, as a sign of the Mosaic covenant, it was in force only as long as the covenant is in force. If the covenant, if the law comes to an end, so does the Sabbath requirement. Now, in dealing with the continuity, let's begin with capital E, unity of the law of Moses, in the bottom of your first page here. The key passage here is James 2:10. James 2:10. And that is that the unity of the law is one unit, so if you break only one commandment, you're guilty of breaking the whole law. If you break a moral commandment, you're breaking the civil law and the ceremonial law. If you break the civil law, you're guilty of breaking the ceremonial law and the moral law, and so on. And although there are 613 commandments, both the Hebrew word and the Greek word are always singular in both languages. And so the point is, the law is a singular unit, cannot be divided into 2 parts or 3 parts, keeping 1 part in and 1 part out. Let's go to your second page. And what the New Testament teaches is the law of Moses was rendered inoperative. For example, Romans chapter 7, verses 1 through 6, he says, we have been discharged from the law. He says we because only the Jewish believers have been discharged from the law, because the Gentiles were never under the Mosaic law. But we Jewish believers have been discharged from the law. Romans 10:4, the Mosaic covenant, Mosaic law came to an end with the death of the Messiah. And so it has come to a termination. The Greek word is telos, T-E-L-O-S. The word is not, this primarily meaning is termination. Not goal, but termination. What that means is there's no justification through the law in Galatians 2:16, and there never was. And while there was a time that you can be sanctified by means of the law, no longer in Hebrews chapter 7, verse 19. Hebrews 7:19. Galatians chapter 3, verses 15 to 19 point out the Abrahamic covenant preceded the Mosaic one by over 4 centuries. And therefore, whatever the Mosaic covenant states, it cannot render the Abrahamic covenant null and void. So why did God give the law? He says to make transgressions clear. To make transgressions clear. And he goes on to say, now that the seed has come, and the seed is the Messiah, we are no longer under the law. The law was given temporarily until the seed should come, and the seed has now come. Galatians 3, verse 23 through chapter 4, verse 7. In this passage, Paul points out that the law was a tutor to bring us to the Messiah. A tutor, a schoolmaster. But now that the tutor has, now that the Messiah has come, we are no longer under the tutor. He defined the tutor as the Mosaic law. In the chapter 4 section, he says that the purpose of the coming of the Messianic God-man was for the benefit of 2 groups. First of all, to redeem them that were under the law. And that them are the Jewish people, only they were under the law. And then he says that we, first person plural, we Jewish and Gentile believers might receive the adoption of sons. That made possible because the law finally came to an end. Hebrews 7, verses 11 through 18. In verses 11 through 14, he points out that the new priesthood required the change of the law. And he first is referring to the promise of the prophecy of Psalm 110, verse 4, that states that the Messiah will be a priest after the order of Melchizedek. But the Mosaic law only allowed one priesthood to function, and that was a Levitical or an Aaronic priesthood. Only that kind of priesthood could function. And therefore, if there's going to be a new priest after the order of Melchizedek, there has to be a change of the law. And in verse 19, he points out that has happened. There's a disannulment. The law has been disannulled. It was now under a new priesthood, and we function under the Melchizedekian priesthood, not the Aaronic Levitical priesthood. The Hebrews 8 verse 13 is at the end of quoting the Jeremiah prophecy about the new covenant. He points out, once Jeremiah said there was a new covenant coming, he made the Mosaic one the old one. If I say I have a new car, the automatically tells you my other car is my old one. That's the point here. The moment Jeremiah said there's coming a new covenant, he rendered the Mosaic one the old one. It was finally rendered inoperative. With the death of the Messiah. So it became old under Jeremiah, finally died away when Messiah died. Ephesians 2:11 through 16, about the middle wall partition, he points out that with Messiah's death, this middle wall of partition has been broken down. And now God has added a third new entity. In verse 15, it calls it the new man. In verse 16, the body, which is the body of the Messiah, the church, is now a new entity comprised of all Jews who believe and all Gentiles who believe, now partaking together of the spiritual blessings of the Jewish covenants. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 2 to 11. That's a good one because he focuses on those commandments inscribed into stone, which are the Ten Commandments. And these are the ones people feel we still have to keep, but most people who say Ten Commandments mean nine. They fudge in the Sabbath issue. And as a result, they make it distinctive. But he points out two things about the Ten Commandments. In verse 7, it's called the administration of death. And in verse 9, administration of condemnation. Administration of death in verse 11, administration, verse 7, and administration of death in verse 9. And twice he then says, both in verse 7 and verse 11, uses a specific Greek word that means to render inoperative. The whole Mosaic law, and especially in this context, the Ten Commandments, has been rendered inoperative. Some people quote the passage you have in your outline, the Matthew passage where it says, "Did not come to destroy the law, but to fulfill," and they use that to show that the Mosaic law is continuous. They quote verse 17, 18, but often don't quote verse 19 where it says, "You must keep even the least commandment." Least commandment of what in that context? The least commandment of the Mosaic law. And since you have to keep it, that must be true today. But what we have to remember is he's speaking to a Jewish audience still under the Mosaic law. And the Mosaic law does not end with the coming of the Messiah. It ends with the death of the Messiah. And as long as he was still living, all 613 commandments were mandatory. And that was the point of that Matthew passage. So today we read several times that we are now no longer under the law, but under grace. That's the contrast. We are not under the law, but under grace. Passages include Romans chapter 6, verse 14, 6:14, chapter 7, verse 4 and 6, chapter 7, verse 4 and 6, Galatians 5:18. Now just briefly, with the time that we have left, let's deal with the law of the Messiah. The name comes from Galatians chapter 6, verse 2. Galatians chapter 6, verse 2. It's called the law of Christ, the law of the Messiah. Romans 8, verse 2. Romans 8, 2 calls it law of the Spirit of life. So by way of definition, it is the many commandments given by the Messiah himself, or through the apostles and the epistles that is relevant to a New Testament believer. Not every commandment he gives is relevant. Now, the turning point is Matthew chapters 12 and 13. In those two chapters, the leadership of Israel rejects him to be the Messiah. At that point, it begins to lay down new rules and regulations that will be incorporated into the law of the Messiah. So, for example, in Matthew chapter 10, he tells the apostles, do not go to the Gentiles, do not go to the Samaritans, go only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Is that the command we follow today? No. That was given for the apostles for a set period of time. What we have to follow is Matthew 28, to get the gospel out to the whole world and disciple all nations and so on. That is the command of the law of the Messiah, not what happened in Matthew 10, what happens in Matthew 28. So again, it's the individual commandments given by the Messiah himself or through his apostles and the epistles, which are relevant to New Testament believer. As far as the purposes, some of the purposes are the same, like to reveal the holiness of God, the standard of righteousness he requires, but there are also some things which are new, not seen before, like certain rules and regulations concerning the new church entity and so on. We have to be kept distinct from the people of the world and Shoah and so on. But especially to show for the believer what it's like to live a spirit-filled life, to show for the believers like to live a spirit-filled life. Let's go down to the provisions. The rabbis, because they wanted to make sure to get all the laws, counted up 613. As far as I know, nobody has counted up the commandments of the law of the Messiah. Let me just make four observations. Number one, many commandments of the law of the Messiah is the same as the law of Moses. For example, 9 of the 10 are repeated in the law of Messiah. The one not repeated is the Sabbath commandment. And that's the reason there is so much confusion among believers today, what is our rule of life. I'll come back to that in a moment. Secondly, many commandments are different from the law of Moses. There's no Sabbath commandments anymore. Romans 14, verse 5, Romans 14, 5, Colossians 2, 16, Colossians 2, 16. There's no dietary code today. That was prophesied to happen in Mark 7, verse 19. Mark 7, 19 finally did happen after he died. Romans 14, verse 20, Romans 14, 20. Thirdly, some commandments are intensified. Some commandments are intensified. For example, the Mosaic Law, Leviticus 19, verse 18, 19, 18 says, do love your neighbor as yourself. A very good commandment. The Messiah called the second most commandment in the entire Mosaic Law. But we all meet people who also hate themselves. So it would be permissible to hate someone as you hate yourself. The love of the Messiah intensifies this in John 15, 12. John 15, 12. Love one another as I have loved you. And how much do you love us? He loved us enough to die for us. That's an intensification of that command. And then a fourth observation is there's a new motivation. The Mosaic code says, do this in order to be blessed. Do these things in order to get the blessing. The New Covenant says, you have been blessed with every spiritual blessing, therefore do. And now we have been blessed with all the spiritual blessings, therefore we ought to do certain things. Let's go back to the first one. Because some commandments are repeated, people often teach this part of the law is still in force. Let me give you another mundane illustration. I received my first driver's license in the state of California. As long as living in California, I had to drive under California vehicle law. I then moved to New York State, had to take a new exam, get a new license, and now I was driving under New York law. Now, some commandments were the same. Both California and New York said, if the light is red, I need to stop. When I stopped for a red light in New York, I didn't stop because California law said I had to. California law became irrelevant to me once I moved to New York. I had to stop because New York state law had said I had to. But California did not borrow the law from New York, and New York now borrowed the law from California. They had the separate state legislators that simply passed the same ruling. Other laws were different. In California, after stopping for red light, you can make a right turn. Now back then, they've changed the law now, but back then when I came to New York, you could not make a right turn in a red light. If I made so and got stopped by a police officer, I could not tell him, well, California law said I can do this. California law, he would tell me, was irrelevant. I'm now under New York vehicle law. And so that's the way we should understand. There may be some of the same commandments, but under two different administrations and passed by two different administrators. Let me also now conclude with the principle of freedom. Freedom from the law means two things. First of all, it frees us from the obligation to keep any of the 613 commandments of the Mosaic Law, but also frees us to keep those commandments that will not violate the commandments of the law of the Messiah. We also have to keep certain principles in mind. If we choose to keep certain commandments of the Mosaic Law as part of freedom in the Messiah, if they carry no value in justification, they carry no value in sanctification. Sanctification now comes through the law of the Messiah. If they carry no merit before God, and for Jewish believers who feel they need to be more Jewish by observing the law, I would have to advise them it does not increase spirituality, nor does it increase Jewishness. And Jewish believers need to avoid getting up every morning and stand before the mirror and say, mirror, mirror, on the wall, who's the most Jewish of us all? And that kind of tendency among some needs to be avoided. But the law, the rule of life is the law of Messiah. And we're free to practice other laws only if they do not negate or terminate or violate the laws of the Messiah. And that is our rule of life. On the corner table back there, I left out some things that I ran out of my brochure on the ministry per se. Ariel Ministries is a Jewish ministry dedicated to two principles. First of all, the evangelizing of Jewish people, and then secondly, to share the word of God intensively with both Jewish and Gentile believers from a Jewish frame of reference, as you've seen this morning. On the corner table, you'll find the information, for example, we have a summer program in upstate New York on the beautiful Adirondacks. It's an 8-week program, but you can come for different weeks. We have a 2-week curriculum, 3-week, 1-week, and 2-week curriculums, and so on, and a special Labor Day weekend. And this will give you all the information and all the courses, and who'll be teaching what, and so on. You can get a lot of material from that same Jewish frame of reference. We also began an online school program that you can take for credit or no credit. You'll find these brochures on the table. And right now you only see 3 programs available. I just finished taping 5 more programs. So there'll be a new brochure coming out soon with 8 new programs. And you can take this at your own leisure using your computer. We also published this magazine, which we publish 4 times a year. It's a quarterly. It usually has anywhere from 3 to 5 different articles from the same Jewish frame of reference. We do not charge for the magazine. So if you want to receive it, just put down on a piece of paper. If you want a hard copy like this, we'll need your full name and address. If you want it as an outline, as an email, just give us your email address, and that will be sufficient. And we'll be happy to keep sending it to you as long as you want to receive it. And we're going to be taking an offering that will go for the work of this ministry. Can we take the offering now and I'll tell another rabbi story? Anybody alive out there? Okay. In the past, I told you stories about the city of Helm, which is found in Poland. As you know, Jewish communities around the world have a reputation for being very intelligent. And this is true. But the Jews of Helm were not famous for being all that intelligent. And many stories come out called The Stories of the Wise Men from Helm, and there's several books called The Wise Men from Helm. And in this story, the rabbi was reading an article and read about ice fishing. He never heard of that before. And in this ice fishing, what he did was read about it, and he wanted to try it. Didn't want to try it alone, so he asked one of his elders of the synagogue to come with him. And Poland has a lot of lakes and streams, and a lot of the fish there is kosher, so they wanted to give it a try. They found some ice, and began digging a hole in the ice. And suddenly he heard a voice from heaven saying, "There's no fish below that ice." They're startled, and one says to the other, "What was that?" And the other one says, "I don't know, but this makes me nervous. Let's go somewhere else." They start cutting a second hole in the ice. And again, they heard a voice, "I said there was no fish below that ice." And the rabbi asked the elder, "Do you think maybe that's God speaking to us?" And the other says, "Well, I don't know if it's God. If it happens again, you better ask. You're the rabbi. You should be the one to ask him. But let's go somewhere else." They start cutting the third hole. And again, they heard the voice, "Once again, there's no fish below that ice." The rabbi gets up his courage and asks them, "Is this God speaking?" "No, this is the manager of the ice skating rink."